All right, everyone, welcome back. S4Y Vlogcast number 20. We finally have arrived in our new Google set. And it is myself, Christian Soto, a.k.a. Mr. Hands. My man, Big Bet Alpha Reg Berkey. I'm really happy. I'm happy the way this set has turned out. It was, you know, a really large investment from our corporate friends.
Me? It was a large investment for me.
Yeah, I mean, Google sent you the check.
No. I pulled money out of my pocket. I bought a bunch of shit. And then I spent the entire weekend putting it together.
How much money is in your pockets?
Not very much any longer.
All right. Well, we are here in a new set. I think this is a beautiful set. I'm really happy to, you know, be the second one to see it. given that you were on a different podcast earlier in the week, but we'll get to that. And let's kind of like begin the talking points of more possible. That's really what this story has been. I do want to talk about the lawsuit. I want to talk about Joe Ingram's role in this entire thing. So let's begin with the lawsuit. Has been $30 million.
Right.
Is what is being seeked by my man. What? What? Seek is not a word?
No.
All right. Well, whatever. I'm fucking Dominican. being sought?
Sought.
I got it, man. I'm the fucking seventh grade teacher. I holla at you. is what is being sought. And what do you think about it? $30 million. Some people said that it's too much. I saw a little bit of Nick Palma talking out there. Talking about
Nick
a bit
Palma?
Too. Hey, man.
I didn't see because he blocked me.
Me too. I heard it from secondhand.
Sure.
Shout out to my man Slay America out there. He defended the lawsuit. He said, yo, fuck these casinos. Get them.
Yo, he just doesn't want a precedent set because he knows that they're going to start coming for him for $30
million. Hey, you know what I'm talking about. All right, so $30 million. It's a pretty big lawsuit. It is. Let's go through what they're trying to do.
Right? Sure.
Okay, so $10 million against POSTLE and his unnamed confederates for fraud based on allegations of cheating. Right. So that's $10 million against POSTLE himself.
Yep.
$10 million against Stones Gambling Hall as an entity for constructive fraud as Stones has a legal duty to monitor the Stones live poker game for cheating and take reasonable steps and measures to prevent the cheating therein. The complaint is also seeking punitive $10 million sum against Stones and JFK on counts of fraud based on JFK's alleged dismissal of the initial allegations and potential cover-up, and another $1,000 for Veronica Brill, effectively Stones saying that this was completely fabricated on the internet. I agree. That $1,000 is important, man. You know what? They also said that I was super surprised of this play, and that they made it seem as if like I was so happy, like oh shit. Like
you might have been one of the commentators in on it, man. That's Polk's theory.
Yeah, I'm in on it. Fuck, I lost. If I was in on it, I wish I would have won.
Yeah, of course.
But
okay. Yeah, man, that $1,000 might be the straw that breaks the camel's back. I mean, you gotta clear Veronica's name.
I agree. Veronica should get that $1,000. They tweeted using my name. I should get more than $1,000 too.
Fuck yeah. Shit. Yeah. So effectively, obviously, this isn't just for the damages that was caused through the cheating.
Of course.
That was like a sum of $300,000. The punitive that they're seeking is effectively trying to set a precedent so that negligence like this doesn't take place in the future, so that cheating like this isn't incentivized by people who are desperate.
Let's talk a little bit about the people involved in bringing this forward.
Okay.
So we got my man Mark Van from Jersey.
Mac.
He's bringing it forward, but he doesn't have a practice in Cali, so he's using a team. And that team is also going to be Poker Out Loud Season 2 participant Kelly Minkin. And let's talk a little bit about the timeline. I don't expect this to be resolved anytime soon unless we see a pretty quick settlement from Stones.
Yeah, I don't think this news story is really going anywhere, but it's dying down, right? Like, this isn't the only thing talked about on Twitter anymore. I think we're returning to normal again, which is good. We should expect some level of normalcy moving forward. I think that we're probably looking at like, you know, I'm not sure how fast this stuff works itself out, but just basing off of like what we know so far about the scandal, I think there's still a lot of details to uncover.
I was shocked that you didn't say the wheels of justice move very slowly. You know, that seems like a thing like for you, like no. These things.
Colloquialisms.
Okay, so yeah, I agree. I think that it's going to be pretty slow. I am interested in your take as it pertains to this. I think if a small settlement comes through, like, I feel as if the poker community as a whole would judge that pretty badly. Like, pretty bad. Effectively, like,
I don't think they'll accept the small segment.
That's what I'm trying to say. Like, I feel like there's pressure on the lawyers to get either a large sum or take this to trial simply because...
I think they want both. I think in order for them to get a large sum, it needs to go to trial. I think they want to be placed in front of a jury. They feel like their case is bulletproof at a civil level where you only need effectively 51%
correct
to get judgment in your favor. So, you know, I don't know that they're going to get the $30 million. I don't know exactly how these processes work. But I do know that we've done all we could do as the community. I think we've put our best foot forward. I think we have a lot of data and evidence out there for the lawyers to now comb through. Mm. I imagine a criminal investigation will begin. We'll never know because, like, obviously that doesn't turn public until it reaches its final stage. Yeah. But yeah, I imagine that this is on the radar enough where it's being looked into from all angles. I imagine that this story will resurface 3 months from now, 6 months from now, certainly around World Series time. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it may even be called upon the community to start digging in a little bit further.
Yeah. I mean, I've added myself onto the lawsuit this week. I think that, you know, I think there's a little bit of reason to. I don't expect to get any sort of like large sum or anything like that, but they did use my name to like promote themselves. I was in the booth. I did lose a little bit of money in the game. And, you know, I even think that everyone that was in the game, even if you didn't play against any hands against him, your EV in the game was so like hurt with his presence
that
you probably should add yourself to the list simply because one person knowing cards changes everything. So it's not necessarily how much you lost directly to him, but how much your EV in the game was hurt.
We also don't know how deep this goes yet. There easily could be other cheaters in this game. Like what I was kind of saying is like, you know, POSTLE in this instance for 18 months represented, or maybe a little less, like 15 months, he represented an effective like empty seat, not empty, but his seat effectively was worth $1,000 an hour.
Yeah.
Right. So it was effectively $1,000 an hour rake on the game. I would imagine the fact that this lasted for 15 months means that there were still other winners in the game.
Oh, of course. But
not necessarily, of course. Yeah, that's a lot to overcome at these stakes.
Yeah.
But if there were other winners in the game, and
we should probably look into
we should definitely be looking into them because it may take perfect information to overcome this.
Yeah.
And if they are legit and they are cleared and, you know, that's all fine. The tape will tell us. That means that the losers in this game were taking a bath.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, like, destroyed. Like, we might have some guys like down six figures playing 1-3-2-5. How do you explain that to your family? How do you explain that away to yourself? Right? Yeah. Like, these guys might be players that, like, maybe they're losing, but not 50 big blinds an hour, not 25 big blinds an hour, not whatever it works out to.
Hopefully, at least what I'm hoping for these players that did lose, the window of loss is small enough that maybe they didn't lose as much because it's only 4 hour stream, or maybe only 5 hour stream,
but for 15 months and it's $300,000 no matter what. It has to come from somewhere.
Yeah.
So the pool has to be like pretty deep for it not to come from like very specific individuals.
On top of that, they were still raking. So there's also rake on top. Like, people are getting crushed.
So small though by comparison.
I know.
Like, now you're looking at like, I don't know, $50-$60 an hour.
Right. But I'm trying to say that's like you're also losing to the rake and losing to more because it's just like,
yeah, so you're adding much like another 3-5% onto his win rate.
Yeah. It's just unreal. So yeah, I'm curious to see how this story moves forward. Obviously the community has been a big help in terms of like placing pressure.
Yeah.
And talking about that, I think that, you know, you're on fucking television. Like, you were on television about this. Joe Ingram has put massive hours. It's almost becoming like a cult following of Joe Ingram at nighttime. Talk a little bit about that. Let's talk a little bit about the community's involvement in this. Like, you were big in like covering the technical side of this, you know, as like, you know, you're a big computer science guy. And
that's not why. It's just because we have the software and I'm familiar with it.
Obviously, we've been using a lot of the software for all our academies. Now it's been, you know, close to 4 years or so of us running academies.
Yeah.
And, you know, we've faced every technical issue imaginable at some point.
So I mean, became really familiar with it. Effectively, I could replicate pretty much all scenarios through which he could have possibly been cheating. And I think that's important to be able to reverse engineer these types of things, because there's that anonymous account or pseudonym account, Rachel Lease. And whoever she is seems to have a pretty deep technical background, seems to be from like the Valley, and have a pretty good understanding of like what's going on in tech. And, you know, a lot of like what she was proposing was there's many ways that this could have occurred, right? There's gaining information through the RFID technology. There is having an insider in production send you the stream. There is, you know, working with other players in the game. There's communication. All of these things are potential ways in which he could cheat. But the correct approach is to go in order and dismiss the ones that are least probable. So like the RFID, like getting a deck in the game and then having some sort of device that is amplified enough that can actually read the deck and read each individual's hand is such a low probability, because that technology is just not there yet, right? Like with what's on the market, it's feasible, but it's really inaccurate. It doesn't function very well. It only has like 3 centimeters worth of readability. So like that's why we're so particular about where players put their hole cards, because if you're even off by an inch or two, now all of a sudden the reader just doesn't pick them up.
Yeah.
Imagine trying to get the 9 seat when you're in the 2, and trying to know what the what that hand is and things like that. So, you know, we could start to dismiss some illogical options and start to put our focus on much more probable ones. And the most probable ones are that he had an insider in production, and the stream is being leaked to him in some capacity.
So you're on TV. Congratulations.
I was on the local news.
Really nothing to ensure that the stream was secure. And due to that, it's very likely that somebody cheated them for 18 months. Like right now, I don't know what that hand is, but if I look at the graphics, I know it's King of Diamonds, Queen of Hearts.
Damn. You gotta, you know, one thing leads to another. You know, next thing you know, you're on ESPN, you're on 60 Minutes. You know, shout out to Gaucho. He was on 60 Minutes. You're almost there. I already got the emails. let's talk a little bit about the way this has been put forth by the community. So Joey Ingram's doing pretty much nightly, like marathon streams, like investigating this entire thing. You're putting out pretty much like a lot of content as it pertains to the technical side of this entire thing. Doug Polk has put out multiple podcasts, multiple like videos about, you know, this entire subject, but we haven't necessarily seen things from what I would call the old guard or the faces we're
used to. That's how I interviewed him, bro.
All right, let's not even count. That was kind of just opportunistic, but like whatever, man. Shout out to Madison. You did a great job. I'm sure that if you really want to listen to how I really feel, you could tune into one of the other things where I said that you shouldn't fucking be recording things in important interviews with when you're goddamn high. At least be sober. Respect us as a community. But I'll digress. Anyway. But we haven't seen things from the old guard. Pretty much, like, I think that they've been a little bit silent on the whole entire subject comparative to what you, Ingram, and Polk have put out. It's just not as much from them. And I'm starting to think that maybe the torch has been passed in not an obvious way. I think because of modern technology, how we're communicating nowadays, it's a situation where potentially they're not on Twitter as much. Although, like, Kid Poker's on Twitter a lot. But, you know, maybe the other faces are not necessarily into, like, recording a video and putting it on YouTube and all this kind of stuff. Does that mean now that we've just moved into another era?
I'm kind of worried that that's not the case, and that it means that we're as a community becoming faceless and more irrelevant. The reason I'm portraying it this way is, well, first and foremost, like, let's talk about the investigation.
Okay.
The big reason why it's me, Ingram, and Polk that are at the head of this is because we each have a lane. And in this instance, you know, Ingram is doing his damnedest to be the guy on the inside, the investigative reporter, the one who's bringing the new details over and over and over again. I have a deep understanding of the technology, and very few people in the community are going to be able to replicate that. Most people just don't own an RFID table, right? So if it wasn't me, it would need to be Somerville, but he's just like, you know, he's pretty removed whenever it comes to this type of stuff. He's not going to be the one who's out there shouting from the rooftops that this guy's a cheat. And then finally, Doug is just like an interpreter for the everyman, he has a big enough following where he can get this message out to pretty much all four corners of the community. So that doesn't really leave any room or place for any of the old guard to really step up and say much other than, okay, yeah, he probably cheated, right? So like, what message would they actually be sending? They're not.
Let me say something, man. God damn it. There's this thing. There's this like thing that bothers people as it pertains to the old guard kind of being like, ah, yeah, he cheated. Ah, yeah, he stole. And like,
well, that's because it was common for them.
That's what I'm saying, though. But like, that's what gave poker a bad rap.
Sure.
So we moved into an era where cheating's not okay.
Yeah.
Robbing from backers or like all this stuff, like that's not okay.
Right. And
like
to stay, the community is policed now.
Yeah. Like to stay silent is not okay anymore.
Well, right. I don't think they were silent. I think that, like, you know, Negreanu did a pod with Veronica and Mattisau did interview Postle. And, you know, it's not that they're silent. It's just they have nothing to add.
I feel as if
they're not going to get their hands dirty on the street level.
That's what I'm trying to say. Like,
right. But they don't need to. Like, you know, no offense, but a year from now, neither will Polk, most likely, unless it's still for views. He's already self-proclaimed retired. Mm-hmm. Right. So, like, how much longer can we expect him to be the quote-unquote voice for the community?
I mean, the truth is that as long as he has a company, is probably going to be that, right?
Sure, maybe.
So, it's one of those things. It's like...
But, like, where do you draw the line? So, like, Gelfand, you know, jumped in a few threads here and there and spoke, you know, very loosely about it.
Listen, man, don't take shots at Gelfand.
I'm not.
That's the godfather. That's the new godfather. You can't take shots at Gelfand. Shout out to Run It Once, man. You know, they've always helped me become a little bit better. I had two coaches, man. It was you and Gotham. Just Gotham didn't know about it.
No, I'm not taking shots at all. I'm just saying that I think that when things like this come to be, there's such a thing as too many chefs in the kitchen. And, you know, first, shout out to, like, the forums out there, Reddit and 2+2. Like, those are the real sleuths. They're the ones, you know, when I say that the old guard's not going to get their hands dirty at the street level, neither are we by comparison, right? Like, yeah, Ingram's putting in the hours, man. He's showing things to the community. But that information's being relayed on a big level from crowdsourcing.
Yeah, because they expect him
right.
to take the reins.
Right.
It's not
right.
Like, why isn't Kid Poker being like with all these things? Why isn't like other... Because
that's just not the lane that he chose, right?
I understand.
But that's not his fault. That's not any of the old guard's fault. We're in a new era.
That's what I'm trying to say.
Right. So, you know... I think if this were a different scandal, like for instance when the Stars Supernova Elite thing happened, I didn't say anything because that's not my lane. I just don't have anything to add. You know, I can give my two cents as to why I think it's a net negative, but overall, like, my opinion is not going to matter for shit. And I think that, you know, you just let it fall as it may. But the reason why I say that I fear that the community is becoming more faceless. And I was talking a little bit about this to Polk on the pod, where if you look back 10, 15 years ago and you look at what was considered to be poker's elite, Negreanu, Helmuth, Ivey, Patrick, Gus, whatever, that whole collective.
How dare you?
Dwan?
Yes, baby.
He's so young.
Man. He was the boss, man. Stop disrespecting him.
Fine, but like, you know, these guys were the bosses before him.
He took over.
That collection at the top, they were friends. There was coordination there.
Right.
Like, half of them backed each other or were like fully invested in the Professor, the Banker, and the Suicide King whenever they played Andy Beal heads up, right? Mm-hmm. So like, they all rose through the ranks together. Our generation, or my generation, and then the generations there to come after, are heavily individualistic. And it shouldn't be this way, where it becomes more and more cutthroat the higher you rise in the ranks. Mm. But we're more disconnected at the top than the bottom is whenever it comes to any sort of like teamwork, any sort of coordination. It takes a scandal like this where we can all agree that cheating's bad and that we all have some sort of value to add that will both promote our selfish motives as well as protect the community. And I think that sucks. I think it's why the training industry is shit. I think it's why a lot of the high stakes games are going private, and in a general sense, it's shit. It's mainly because we've been bred to be EV robots where there's no comprehension of the old gambler's maxim, giving action to get action, right? Like, we're that first wave of if you're not focused on your sole EV, then you're getting skinned alive.
So let's talk about the Polk interview. Let's talk about how you think it went.
I think it went really well. I think that there was a ton of positive feedback. People were happy to see us get on the same platform.
There was a lot of... So I didn't watch too much, but I read the comments.
Yeah.
So, you know, that's what's really important. You know?
Right.
So I read the comments. They were like, man, I didn't really like Berkey, but like, he's kind of okay. And like, man, Berkey really didn't deserve all this lashing from Polk all these years and stuff like that. So that seems that it was a positive for you to go on his platform and people kind of view you differently because they only view what he was putting out. And what he was putting out was like, oh, Berkey sucks. Like, the Berkey hands or whatever. Yeah. Berkey files or whatever he called it. Right. So continue. What do you think?
I mean, honestly, that was a discussion that I wish we would have got into. I'm actually shocked that like we talked 90 minutes and never really addressed the obvious elephant in the room.
You know what made me mad?
What?
That you invited him here.
I didn't invite him here.
Dan
invited him here.
Come to the software. You think Polk was going to sit in my seat?
If we were going to do a live podcast, would you rather that I do it on his set or on ours?
I'm going to give him a new seat. He's not sitting in my seat with my Dominican flag behind him. There's no fucking way that's happening.
I would have taken the flag down.
All right, I'm just saying. I would have put a soft white logo back there.
Yeah, for sure.
I'm just making sure. Like, you ain't taking my seat in the Dominican. You ain't repping DR. You ain't sitting in my seat. But go ahead.
I am kind of surprised that it didn't come up because it was not only not coordination, but like, you know, his business tactics have always been pretty transparent from day one. And I think he's just very good at executing that strategy. So he had the loudest megaphone. He understood that. Mm-hmm. And we were a competitor, maybe not that much competition since we were niche and a lot smaller by comparison. We weren't at that time even doing an online training site or whatever. But when you're able to captivate the largest audience and send your message the loudest, it's just smart to dismiss people.
Yeah.
And it's way easier to go after me than it is Galfon because Galfon's the godfather.
Can't go to Galfon.
Right. Galfon. He's untouchable.
He's untouchable.
So like, you just hope that like he fucks up somehow and you can capitalize on it. I've never cared all that much. That's why I never clapped back. That's why like when we did it in a very self-deprecating kind of way. I think it was just business for him too. Like he was amicable from the start to the finish of the interview. We almost got into it and it just didn't, he like circled around the drain and then scurried off.
That's what happens.
But like he was kind of saying that he was unfairly portrayed.
He was unfairly portrayed.
As the GTO guy.
Oh yeah. Let's talk about that.
Well, and what I started to say, I go, what do you mean? Like you projected that, you absolutely sold that message.
It was good business to sell that message.
Right. And what I wanted to continue to say or like, further that conversation with was that you drove all narratives and like I am now considered a certain way because you have the megaphone to do that. And now that I've been on your pod and people have heard me speak and I've had a bigger platform, a lot of that will probably be diluted. Now, you know, I played a lot of crazy hands, so it is what it is. Like nobody's going to take away my loose qualifications. Nobody's going to say that I'm not a lag, but I think there's going to be a lot fewer people that are going to think that I just started playing poker 3 or 4 years ago. Mm. Don't know what the fuck I'm doing. And was just pumping off at the biggest stakes in the world.
Let's just be something clear because I did see some of the interview. Mm. And one of the things I did see was the fact that he said he didn't use solvers.
I actually got a little bit misconstrued as the I only do GTO guy for God knows what reason.
Misconstrued? Sure, you painted yourself that way.
I didn't though. I really didn't.
Have you seen an episode of Poker Hands?
I've never even used a solver. See, I've never even used one.
We're the same, man.
In my whole career.
Right.
And that was surprising to me because of what you're saying. He drove the narrative of like GTO is king.
Right.
Right. If that's the case and you are the biggest proponent of this style, then it seems as if you've been working with solvers since the Dream Machine.
Right.
You've been working since the beginning, right?
Right?
But what I think is that doesn't mean he sucks. That doesn't mean that you don't think in a certain way, in a theoretical way.
Mm-hmm.
It just seems as if it was bad business for you to say that you didn't use solvers.
Right. I guess let me start with the fact that he said he didn't use solvers. Mm. I'm not surprised at all for a couple of reasons. First, we've both been playing long enough where we know poker pre-solve. That doesn't mean that we did, that doesn't mean that we didn't start studying until solvers came to be. So I particularly remember a conversation that he and I had at Five Diamond. Man, it had to be like 2015 or 14, something like that. Mm-hmm. Where we were talking about like what our Google Drives were worth. Mm. And that's because both of us had diligently like built out these strategies, you know, had data to back it and things along those lines. You know, it's a lot of like how I taught you. Mm-hmm. And that all does come from critically thinking. That does come from a lot of the principles that solvers introduce from a game theory standpoint. Pre-solvers, game theory still existed.
Of course.
Right? Like, I can remember playing Connect 4 in like 2009 and realizing that it was a solvable game. Mm-hmm. And then like researching what the actual solve was and kind of like reverse engineering it from there.
It's not as if he didn't keep notes. It's not like... He had like entire spreadsheets of moves and things like this, similarly to how your Google Drive was entire list of hands played, what you thought about, like all these things. So it's not as if you two aren't thinking. And ironically, it's very similar then,
right,
in terms of like how you're approaching the game.
Yeah, I think his was just a lot more data driven because he was playing online. Mm-hmm. So, and that's where we're at now, right? Like we here just like profess a lot of macro principles. And the irony was when we were talking about it, I think we were kind of talking past one another because I was speaking to that. I was saying like, look, I agree with you. I continually kept saying like, I agree with you fundamentally. It's very important to understand the macro principles of game theory. What drives this game, right? It's EV and pot odd investment strategies. That's it. It's that simple. Now we can build off that tree. If those are the two stumps and we want to build those trees out, then we start getting in a little bit deeper to the aggressive paths versus the passive paths, realization versus capitalization, range analysis, range versus range analysis versus hand versus range analysis, and you know, kind of still digging into the macro, right? These are all still very, very, very big principles. And his pushback to that was kind of just like, no, you can create a micro system that can be taught, and as people are implementing this micro system, they'll learn the macro principles just through sheer osmosis or kinesthetic learning.
This is kind of how I approach my clients pretty much. I don't like teaching moves without the background of why these things work, right, in a big picture sense. Mm-hmm. The reason why that is because if I teach the moves, if one thing is changed in real time, the whole thing blows up,
right,
and you just punt, right? Right? So effectively, I don't like teaching moves, and then all of a sudden we change a card that looks similar, but is not exactly the same.
Or we change position, or we change position. Stack depth.
Correct. Everything changes.
Right.
So it's more important, at least in my mind, for the person to understand the concepts, mm-hmm, understand why things function a certain way. That way, as we change the variables, you can still change in your thinking.
Right.
Right. You develop a much more dynamic way of thinking, rather than a very strict guideline.
Right.
And from what I gathered in the interview, it was like, okay, how I coached my stable at, mm-hmm, the time, right, are just going to be people that are just implementing these moves from the spreadsheet.
Right. It's very similar to like how people are implementing PO now. They are getting enough brushstrokes where they're able to extrapolate on small scale, right? So they can go over the aggregate boards and then identify how that extrapolates out to all boards. They can go over their entire range from a position and understand like the application model, at least on the flop. Things might start to get a little hazy on turns and rivers, but you know, they'll just keep studying those spots until they feel more comfortable. The problem is, and what I challenged them on is, I said, you know, the system that you taught in 2013, do you think it wins now? Right. And he said, no. And I go, right, because the game is continually evolving. It's so endless in its potential, right, that we're going to continually refine, and new waves of strategy and counter strategies are going to constantly present themselves. So it's much more critical to learn from a macro standpoint where we understand what principles we should be examining first. Like when we're talking about the way ranges are comprised, right, we have to understand the basic principles under construction. And that's going to be stack depth, it's going to be position, and it's going to be the attributes of the actual hand that you're dealt, right? We need certain attributes throughout the top to the bottom of our range. We need showdown value, we need connectedness, and we need suitedness, right? And it's going to be some mix of all of those things, but we can't just restrict ourselves to one. So we can't just say all hands in this range have to have showdown value because now we're too tight. And we can't just say all hands in this range have to at least have one or yeah, at least have one of these characteristics. Because now if we start adding offsuit connectiveness, we're way too wide, right?
From you, I got a lot of exploitative like moves, that, not moves, a lot of exploitative thought process, which I think is extremely valuable, especially today. Mm-hmm. Like, you make a lot. One of the things I realized is, like, I don't think people know how to play against weak players.
Yeah.
Like, they just, like, leave piles of money in the weak, reg versus weak environment. But I started, you know, when I started listening to Sauce and, you know, one of these, like, authorities on theory, right? He always spoke about the GTO approximation. Mm-hmm. And I think that's where we're kind of talking about. Like, for you to understand approximately what this spot looks like in theory, you have to understand why the theory thinks this way, right? And that'll give you a scope to work on. And you're never going to get it perfectly right because you can't split the way that PO splits. But if you can have an estimate of why certain things are approached in a certain manner, then you could take that, multiply that with your how far you want to move away from your approximation based on real environment. Then you have an answer to your things. But I think if you're just implementing moves, and I don't want to beat a dead horse, if you're implementing just Google Sheet says this or PO says this, you're going to get in a lot of tricky spots because there's too many variables, especially in live poker.
Where we're playing. Well, just eventually the environment's going to adapt.
Correct.
Because like no matter what, at the end of the day, you're still operating in exploits.
Yeah.
No matter what and how theoretically sound a system is that's built, mm-hmm. it's still heavily exploitative. So there's still a counter strategy to employ against it. And that's effectively the way that we study once we start to get to a higher level is we examine our strategy as a whole and then we try to beat ourselves, mm-hmm. right? So like on a very small scale, the best approach is to be Colotico, right? Just play yourself over and over and over and over again while you're refining each and every spot. Now, the problem is we're human and that's very difficult to do at any sort of scale. So really you're playing yourself or you're figuring out how to beat yourself in the current environment and what makes most sense, right? So whenever you say like, oh, okay, like my biggest hole here is that versus this bet sizing on river, I call too much. Then you have to kind of ask yourself like, well, how often is the field choosing this size? And when you realize that like, oh, the field just doesn't bet 2x pot very often on the river, you're just like, okay, I'm safe.
Look at yourself in the mirror, go on the Doug Polk podcast, you'll find out great.
I mean, honestly, like I really hope that it is kind of like the first crack of a spider web in a windshield that this
what go ahead
let me go ahead and start that one over.
No, continue. The spider web in a windshield.
No, it's too complex. I hope that this is kind
I get
of
it
like,
I get it. It's like if you throw a rock at the windshield, it starts small and then it spreads, right? Yeah.
Yes,
exactly. We're almost there. Okay. We're almost there.
All right.
Casi tamo ahí.
I hope this is the kind of ripple effect where people start to look in a little bit further and understand that Doug was claiming that he was unfairly the GTO guy, and I'm claiming that I'm unfairly the exploitative guy, when the reality is that at the end of the day, if you've made it to high stakes, you think in a particular way. You think about the game in a holistic way where the theoretical principles are what drive you. You are able to analyze range versus range. And the fact of the matter is a very small percentage of people who play poker can actually think in terms of my range versus my opponent's range, period.
Right. And then even
end
move,
of story.
And then even be talented enough to move into an exploitative realm after that.
Right.
Right.
And the thing is, it might not even be that much talent. It might just be your ability to observe, right? The way that you ultimately arrive at your decisions whenever you are capable of thinking that way is, well, what am I incentivized to do with this particular hand plucked out of my exact range?
The crazy part is I, for one, probably have consumed so much content in terms of like watching all the videos, going on like competitive sites and like watching their stuff, mm-hmm. watching streams, like all these things. And many times, especially with Doug, I was just like, this is not PO approved. Like, this is an exploitative move.
Yeah.
And I'm just like yelling in the room.
The
like,
problem is the label. Like, I hate the term exploitative.
Right.
I hate it so fucking much because it's like, are you human?
Right.
Are you playing poker? You're exploitative then.
Right.
Period. Like, this notion that somehow we're on this search for the Holy Grail where one day Sauce is just going to rise from a phoenix. and just say, I've done it. I've played every decision in the tree perfectly. Right? It's just, it's never, ever going to be attained in any of our lifetimes.
Yeah, I agree. Let's get into Poker Out Loud. We've just filmed the last, the most recent season. Not the last season of Poker Out Loud, but the more recent season. That's going to be season 4.
It's 4:30. Poker Out Loud, season 4, day 1. We're supposed to shoot at 4. We're not even close. But don't tell the players that. Seems like they're still trying to figure out how tournament sims work. They're going to be switching seats all the time. There's not going to be a winner because it's all for education, which sucks because then production can't bet on it. So the players today for Poker Out Loud Season 4, MTT version, Matt Berkey, Christian Soto, who has never won at Poker Out Loud, Brent Hanks, Matt Hunt, Andrew Chewy Lichtenberge, and who's the other fucking guy? No, that was 6. Jesse Sylvia, World Series of Poker runner-up at some point, like 10 years ago. Like Osiris and Isis, parables written inside papyruses, acknowledge it. We've been all tricked, time to come out of it. Seeds watch us, grow up and try to follow us. Police watch us, roll up and try knocking us. One knee I duck, could it be my time is up? With my luck, I got up. The cop again, bus stop glass bursts, a fiend drops his Heineken. Ricochet. I'm just gonna fold because I'm verging on potentially doing something really silly without enough justification for it. All I need is one mic. Don't show that I'm smoking. Berkey's on this health kick. This is part of my 500-day fitness challenge. All I need is one mic. That's all I need. All I need is one mic. All I need. All I need is one mic. All I need is one cup, one page, and one pen, one prayer.
When he does a side of bet here, which is largely like a blocker bet sizing, he doesn't have that many bluffs. All I need is one mic. That's all I need.
All I need is one mic. I can still hear. Hold on.
Yeah, okay. Me too.
I need to go deaf.
So season 4A will be the MTT version, right, which will feature a bubble play scenario in 2 different tournaments.
Right.
Right. One of them is going to have a smaller pay jump. One is going to have a bigger pay jump as it pertains to the first cash after the bubble. And we play it. And it was really interesting as it pertains to how many actual decision points there are if you're a short stack, if you're a middle stack, if you're a big stack, right? And people play tight. If you're good, you play tight, right? That's kind of...
I mean, here's the thing. It's like, it's one of those things where if you're truly interested in learning, I guess you'll be enthralled
right
by the decision-making process that's just very obvious to the naked eye. It's a lot of fucking folding.
Yeah, it's a lot of folding.
But it is going to be half a season of folding. But the reasons behind the folds and the particular spots that are taken are where I think all the value really comes from.
Yeah, I think it's one of those things where if you are someone like me, who's just like really like combing through, like just watching every micro decision of what a pro's thinking in that exact spot and trying to add it onto your game, or like seeing like, okay, he made a mistake, but why? Or he made a really good play. Why did that work? Now I think that's where the real value comes in. If you're trying to see people like bang it out, like you're not going to see that.
Right? Yeah, that's 4B.
Right. Exactly. So then we're moving into the next one, which is what you're used to seeing, right? Which is going to be cash on, you know, high level cash action, you know, people banging it out like with some really interesting spots. Like I think me and Nick Howard play like one of the more interesting hands that I've ever played in my life. I think that it was really entertaining. I thought it was like really tough action.
Nick. Yeah, this guy's bluffed by everybody.
I wanted to bury him, you know. Fucking my Dominican flag, baby. Rep that flag.
He got out of line twice. He got punished both times.
Yeah, La Patria.
It's a good sign.
La Patria comes in.
Mm-hmm.
I'll rip your fucking head off. All right. And then finally, we did pros versus students. So yep. there was MTT, there was pro on pro, and then there was pro versus students. So it was pretty much me, you, and did Hunt play that one?
No, four students.
Okay, so it was me and you versus the team of students.
Yep.
And on top of that, we did a draft where I got to pick my students and you got to pick your students in like a round robin kind of a way.
Yep.
And they didn't know who they were drafted by.
Right.
And it was pretty funny because throughout the season, I'm like giving pound to someone. And then like they think they're on my team, but they weren't even on my team the whole time.
They didn't even know there was a draft.
Oh, good. Nice.
Yeah. So I think that that'll be an interesting product to kind of showcase. We wanted to get Poker Out Loud out to everybody, whether they're a subscriber or not. I thought this student version was a pretty good way to go about it. So look for that around the first of the year. We're going to be putting that season out on YouTube. I think we're going to do a shortened version of On Second Thought, which is our podcast where we comb through the episodes of Poker Out Loud and pick out the more interesting spots and talk through them. So I think what we'll do is just one hand per episode.
Mm-hmm.
And we'll give everybody a kind of glimpse of what that product looks like too.
But if you want us to do two hands, what can they do? What can they do? We set up a Patreon or something. They donate to us. We can get like some new hands out there. Maybe like a secret version. Just, you know?
I mean, we sign up to the site. We'll do as many hands as you fucking want.
All right. Not as many hands as you want, you know, but I'm not going to be here all week just like, so in this hand, we're going to open Queen Jack offsuit. But let's talk about that hand.
Yeah.
All right. So I do want to talk about a season three highlight hand.
Okay.
And it's, if you're a poker nerd, if you're someone that like really likes digging into why certain things work, mm-hmm. then I think this hand particularly is going to be a fun one.
Yeah. It's not glamorous to look at. You know, you could skim right past it and just say like, oh, okay. I mean, that was a big pot with not much of a hand by either person. But if you dig into the nuances of why each of us were taking the lines that we took, I think it's a pretty fascinating one.
All right. So let's play this hand.
Okay.
All right. So we're going to get ourselves in another situation here. I have a hand that could probably go either way. I think King 10 suited would be a better hand to start working into my flat call range. King 9 just serves me a lot better as a 3-bet. Chu's obviously going to be open the button quite widely, so I'm just going to go after him in a very standard fashion.
150. So facing a 3-bet button small blind here. Pretty standard call. And just proceed post-flop accordingly.
So we find ourselves in a very precarious spot. The thing about this texture is that I won't be firing multiple shells no matter what my hand range is. And I am kind of incentivized to be checking at some rate because my down bet is going to be really inefficient here. Chewy's just going to have a lot of calls. Outside of his ace-x and 10x, he's going to have some pocket pairs. He's going to have broadways that can't fold. He's going to have backdoors that can't fold that could possibly apply pressure later. I think it's easier for me to build a check-raise range here than it actually is for me to build a bet-bet range. All of those reasons are leading me towards a check here. And I think my hand is actually okay as a check-raise, but I would probably just continue through as a check-call. And then lead some good turns. So I'm going to start off with a check.
So after Berkey 3-bets, he checks this flop. It is somewhat understandable. There's definitely some hands that don't want to bet. I think my best option is a bet on the slightly larger side here. I fold out some of his hands that are relatively no equity that I beat. I begin putting pressure on some of his ace-x type holdings. And I potentially set up a multi-street bluff.
150? I'm sorry, 225. Yeah.
Okay, so I'm not that surprised to see him take initiative and bet here. I actually think he would check back a lot of his ace-x. So I imagine that he is rather pulled whenever he starts betting here. Maybe ace-x of hearts chooses to bet and some ace-x of clubs, though I block a handful of those combinations. Check calling actually performs very poorly here, especially to this sizing. After I checked, I kind of realized that a lot of Chewy's betting range is just going to barrel off. And even if I dominate it, like perhaps his, say, queen jack, queen nine type holdings, it doesn't really help me any, because even when I improve to, say, the jack of clubs on the turn, I have no real availability to take control of this pot and win. So what I'm going to do instead is elect a check raise here, and if and when Chewy does choose to continue, I'll just be shutting down on even improved cards. So I'll be taking a check raise check line on even a good turn for me, such as a club. Because I'm shutting down turn, I really need to be pulling out here. So I'm gonna choose something in the neighborhood of pot. So we're gonna make it 875, just slightly under pot.
So definitely a pretty unusual spot to face a check raise. It seems like a board where, were he to have a strong hand, he would want to either bet or check call. That being said, against my relatively polarizing in position bet, yeah, it seems perplexing that he would want to raise many hands and do it for a size where, against a polarized range, well, I guess if he thinks I have a relatively polarized range, he would want to play similarly. I guess my choice here is call, hope he shuts down, and make a small turn bet, or just fold straight away. I could be drawing dead. It's very possible that some of my my pairs are possibly good. If they're good, my hand might be good. My one out to a straight is possibly somewhat tainted if he has a hand like King 10. Yeah, I think all in all, it's just probably a spot that I have to fold.
All right, so you're getting out of line. That's really what's happening here.
No, no, no.
Oh, it's like PU approved out of line.
Not, yeah, this is approved. This
okay.
is fine.
This is the shit I don't like about today's game, right? It's like, oh, you got out of line. No, PU approved it. Oh, okay.
Well, like, right. Well, first of all, I don't need PU to approve it.
Hell yeah, you speak for yourself, bro.
And secondly, like, I just intuitively think that this is the correct play versus the sizing that Chewy selects.
Okay, so he chooses 225 into 310. So a little bit, I would say, on the polarizing sizing. He's not going to be betting too many hands for this sizing, you know, for that.
I think the problem is that he shouldn't be betting really much Ace-X at this size.
Correct.
I think it's fine if he does. Like, if he chooses to bet a hand like Ace-Jack or if he has Ace-Queen, it's kind of okay.
Yes.
But the problem is that he should just expect a lot of folds.
Definitely not Ace-Jack, but I agree.
Right.
Maybe Ace-Queen.
Right. So here's what's going on. He's leveraging his 10 advantage here. Mm-hmm. With a large size, which allows him to effectively race to a pole. Mm-hmm. The issue is that because I'm 3-betting from the small blind, I should be much more linear in nature. So Sure, he'll have some 10 advantage because he'll have some offsuit varieties where I just won't. But it's not going to be quite as advantageous as it looks. Secondly, though he does have a bluffing candidate in this particular hand, he's probably going to have far fewer actual bluffing candidates than the size would also dictate.
See.
So he doesn't have a lot of tens. He may have 10 advantage, but like when it all boils down, we might be talking about like 12, 13 combos.
Yeah.
Something in that nature.
Well, the reason I think he has some more 10 advantage is because you're not necessarily always going to be 3-betting your offsuit variety, where he's often going to be defending some of his offsuit variety.
Yeah, yeah. That's kind of what I just said.
I know, but he'll I'm trying to explain for the people listening.
Right, yeah. He'll have some offsuit, but yo, who knows how much.
Right.
So let's give him the benefit of the doubt and let's say that he has like half the jack tens, half the queen tens, and then only king ten suited, right?
But he also have the ace ten, probably in fold.
Right, but ace ten shouldn't choose this size.
I agree.
So let's discount ace ten to zero, because if he chooses this size with ace ten, I'm probably just folding or punting off with my hand. Mm. So I have the king of clubs, but the ten of clubs is out, so that doesn't block anything. So he has two king tens. He has one combo of quads, which again, I don't think should choose this size, but whatever, we'll give it to him. He will have six combos of queen 10, six combos of jack 10.
Okay.
So we're looking at 14 to 15 combinations total.
Yeah.
Now let's look at what his reasonable bluffs are. King, okay. King, queen, queen, jack.
Maybe also a hand like jack nine suited.
Sure. Yeah. Fair. So let's say he has three combos of jack nine suited. Maybe he's only incentivized to bluff with...
Well, he has four combos of jack nine.
No, suited. I have...
Oh, but you have
one. I have one. The nine of clubs. Right. So let's... Yeah, whatever. Let's add them all. So three combinations of jack nine suited. I guess we can give him four combos of king, queen. So yeah, 12 combos
king,
of
queen.
King,
queen is
king,
not
queen.
A good...
It's not great.
Right, right.
It's not great, but it does block my best aces, which is
fair.
Somewhat important. Yeah, I mean, let's say he bluffs half the time with king, queen, 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 jack, and king, jack, right?
Okay.
So that's 18 combos.
Okay,
so,
let's just give, yeah, it, yeah. Give it a round.
Let's say it's roughly 20 combos, right? Okay. So he has like 15 combos of value, 20 combos of bluffs. That's a fair ratio to bet a large size. But what I'm confident in is that he'll bet the value for this size. What I'm not confident in is that he's always choosing the size as a bluff.
Okay.
What I felt in game, though, was the exact opposite. Mm. So I'm saying this now retroactively looking at it, that I think he could choose this size with value, but may hesitate a little bit with bluffs. But... maybe that's kind of like a false narrative, because the reality is that because he's not really choosing this size with ace X, it kind of just naturally forces him a little bit more towards the bluff side, because right. The purpose of this sizing is to get folds.
Right.
Right. And I still have nut advantage because I have aces in full.
Effectively, I think this happens a lot, especially in live games where like the turn overbet is used or mm-hmm. like river overbet is used, things yep. like that. It's like, are you really doing this with all your value hands?
Kind right, of thing. Right,
like
right.
It's like,
I think, if I had a calling hand, if I had a hand like ace king, ace queen, ace jack, something along those lines, I think I would have called very likely to expect an overbet on the turn, and I've just gotten sticky and never folded.
Naturally, as like a human, right, you have to have a lot of discipline. Not saying Chewy's an elite player, I'm just yeah. talking in general, having the discipline to use these sizes to balance your range rather than like taking a little bit off
and just targeting,
right? Exactly.
Yeah, just target my range, right? It's like, yeah, in theory, if you go big, bigger, biggest, my ace x is in hell, and if I just always call, you are going to absolutely destroy me. But if you think that you're going to land in the spot with a 10 a lot, and I'm going to have an ace a lot, and take a check flop line, and just like check call three, that's a pretty big parlay of events, right? It's just much more practical to recognize that I have a pretty robust check calling range, and that very quickly changes when the price is poor.
Okay,
like I checked king nine suited to call, but then he bet 2/3 pot. And it was like, well, now I'm in a polar situation where I can only raise or fold. And so I just chose the former.
Yeah. I mean, that's usually where your raises are going to come from. It's mostly going to come from hands that are, you know, slightly outside of the
right.
the ability to continue as a call.
Yeah.
So I thought that season went really well. I'm really looking forward to what people will think about this next season as we start changing things up a little bit. And I'm excited. I'm excited for the evolution of Poker Out Loud. I feel like it's...
I'm excited to get more eyes on it because I do really think it's a really fantastic learning tool. I mean, I don't know many other places where you're going to get in-game play-by-play thought analysis from Chewy, from Nick Howard, from myself, from Jesse Sylvia, from you, from Hunt, from the cast of characters that we've had play throughout. So it's like that, it's a really humbling thing because we're making errors.
Oh, for sure.
We're human, right?
For sure.
But... We're called upon justifying those errors in the exact moment.
You know what's interesting, though? Even when you make an error, like Poker Out Loud has been, at least for me, one of the things that have grown my game, you know, and I've tossed around the idea of even letting like people come in, obviously for a price, you know how I work, but come in for a price and just be like, hey, like we'll provide this service for you where like you speak your thoughts out loud on film in game against tough players of your peer group. And you guys see why you've missed a step, why you certain things. And then I'll commentate on this exact thing through, you know, for your service, you know? So I've tossed that around just because for me, it's been one of like the biggest things. Even when I make a good play, it's like, well, what was I exactly thinking in that right. spot? When I make a bad play, even better, it's like, why did I make that play? What was my thought process in that exact spot? And then when I see other people that I respect make a mistake, it's like, okay, what caused that mistake, and can I put that onto someone when I go play at the Wynn?
Right. And this goes back to the conversation we just had where it's like, if we get rid of the terminology of game theory optimal and exploitative and just recognize that we're operating on some spectrum where those are just the two endpoints, then what we realize is that having the principles that guide your decision points, which is what you'll hear in the thought process in Poker Out Loud, right? You'll understand that we're driven by the pot odds model. You'll understand that we're driven by the properties of our hand, the properties of our range construction, all of these things. That's ultimately what's going to lead us to a decision. If you recognize that, and then also recognize that we're making that decision biased upon the information that we're receiving in real time, then you'll understand why we're all exploitative, right? Because that information matters, and it's the only information afforded to us. The bet size, the position, the player that it came from, the tendencies we've recognized, all of those things are going into this process, and they're funneling through these filters of what are the properties of the hand, what are the positions that we're in, what's the stack depth, what's he incentivized to do, what am I incentivized to do, right? We're answering all these questions in a matter of seconds in real time, and that is 100% why a Mike Postle win rate can't exist. It's 100% why we're all on the exploitative spectrum. It's 100% why the lie of pursuing game theory optimal is just a bullshit holy grail that isn't going to be attainable. And that's not to dilute the practice of studying theory.
Or the people that are searching for the holy grail.
Right, yeah. It's just to be real, right? It's just to make everybody understand that this game is alive and well. And like I said, we're just going to continually go around in circles. Certain things are going to become en vogue. They're going to fall out of popularity. The strategy that is working today won't work tomorrow. The counter strategy that works efficiently now won't work 5 years from now, et cetera, et cetera. And we have to just like be happy with that.
Let's talk about stream games. So we're always in search for high value spots, especially, you know, you and I that are like, you know, playing like... Obviously, you're playing high stakes, but I'm playing like mid to high stakes. And what I'm finding is like some of these stream games are pretty high valuable.
They're nice.
I feel as if...
Are they valuable enough to get cheated on?
No.
Are you sure?
No. I am sure. But I'm looking around. I'm looking around for these games that are streamed. I'm looking and I'm seeing like, okay, the run it upstream is pretty high value, right? Looking at some of these live at the bike lineups. Pretty high value for these games.
Yep.
Like maybe some of the Friday night pokers that were going on, some of the poker after darks that I've seen. So do you think maybe this is the next high value seeking spot where like if you could be invited to these streams, maybe you're in high value spot?
I think it's very critical for everybody to comprehend that incentives in business have to align both with the business operator itself and its clientele.
Yes.
And this gets a little tricky because effectively the players in this instance are kind of like subcontract workers, right? So the actual clientele for the stream houses are the viewers.
Correct.
But they need the talent. So they have to subcontract that out. And the issue is that the incentives don't align between the two. Mm-hmm. So now there needs to be a value proposition from the stream house to the player because the player is bringing value by being a part of it.
Correct. This is why the, you know, GSNs, you know, all these people were paying the players.
Right.
That was the initial incentive to play. You were getting $1,000 an hour to show up.
But again, that goes back to the business end of it. So you have to look where incentives are, right? They were getting massive amounts of ad dollars from online sites. Mm-hmm. So they were heavily incentivized to ensure that they put out the best product possible in order to make their advertisers happy and everybody gets to make a lot of money.
Correct. So now that is not there, at least currently, the incentive for the player to show up is one, potentially not pay rake. So if stream houses are forcing players to pay rake, I think that's completely unacceptable. I've said that earlier.
Yeah.
And I'm going to reiterate that.
Yep.
You cannot have your players paying rake.
Yeah. And I think tip is different, right?
Like tip completely different.
Right.
Completely, utterly different. Like we're going to take care of the dealer because we understand. Although like there's been some controversy there where like maybe they should take care of their own dealers.
They probably should.
But like, fine. I'm okay with the dealer part of it, right? But
well, the only reason I would say they probably should is because the whole backing behind the players taking care of the tips is ensuring good service.
Yeah.
We don't, but in a stream game, you don't have the option to not tip. Like, you don't have the option to be like, that dealer was actually shit.
Correct.
You should do a better job. I'm not tipping.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I guess you have the option, but like you're not going to do it on camera.
Doesn't seem that way.
Right. Yeah, there's a high pressure to tip. So it probably should be something that the stream house takes care of.
Yeah, I agree.
But now we're asking for a lot, right? Because I'm asking for more stringent protocols. I'm asking for either software upgrades or at least a set of metrics in place that ensure the security of the current softwares that are being used. I'm asking for locked doors, bigger staff, privileged information absolutely needs to be protected to the highest degree. And that's probably not happening many places outside of the Nevada streams. Although I did see Bart Hansen tweet today that Best Bet Jacksonville's running a stream, and he was really impressed with how thorough they were with their security. They had everything behind a locked door. Everything was hardwired, etc. I think that's great. I think that players have the right to ask those questions before playing on a stream to be reassured that everything is on the up and up. But again, like the whole point I'm trying to arrive at is now if we're also telling them that they should pay the rake, they should provide hotels for the players, they should tip the dealers, whatever the case may be, we're looking at a lot of overhead to run a stream.
All right. Well, I am going to be doing some commentary potentially next week. Not potentially, but actually next week for WSOP Europe, which is going to be a lot of fun. I think that
big stage, a lot of high rollers.
Hey, puppy, I'm excited. You know, they brought in the Dominican to talk about the Europeans. Like, that's what's up, man. We're international right now. SoftY International Enterprises. Here we got me, Dominicano, Americano. I am ready to go every day, 5 a.m. Let's go.
It's at 5 a.m.?
If they want me to be.
Okay.
They said, it starts at 5 a.m., but like, we're not really, we're not expecting you to come in at 5. I was like, I'll be there at 5 a.m., man. I'll be there at 5 a.m. You don't know how, when you want something, you got to go. You can't, you know what I'm saying? When you want to be.
I see where the gym falls now because you ain't ever joined me at 5 a.m. for the gym.
Hey, man, you know, I've said that I can hang in the commentary with anyone on the planet. I've said I've studied commentary. I've just how I studied Durr back in the day. I'm just sitting there just like listening to Nick Schulman, just listening. Like I'm just learning, you know? And then I think he's exceptional. He's elite, you know? So I'm listening. I'm trying to add those things onto my repertoire. And I think I have a natural tack for just like commentary in general. And so with that being said, I want to launch a small segment of the show.
Okay.
Right. It's going to be an investigation segment.
Right? Another one?
No, this is different. This is like, I'm just going to pop something on you.
Okay.
And I want to see what you think, how people feel when certain things happen. Right. Okay. It's loose. It's not supposed to be like, oh, apostle, like whatever. You know, right. Like this is going to be chill. You know what I'm saying? So I want you to look at what I sent you. Right. Okay. And we're going to put it up on the screen. I want you to just describe what caused this, because this person is hurt. They need something out of life. And I think that you are the person that can guide them in the right direction. I personally think this person was cheated on because if we read right over her lip,
right? Sure.
It says, she said,
fucking death in the ass.
Holy fuck. Bro, this is holy shit. Go ahead.
Although you were, it could be married. It could say although you were married.
Yes, it's M-A-R. I definitely see that. Yeah. Married for sure. I'm telling you, my read was spot on.
And then I think it says thug life. Or maybe it says your wife.
Oh, that's what it says. That's what it says. Married your wife.
She said I was, can't read. Happiness, just less, can't read. I mean, you know,
this is what it is.
This is illegible, man.
No, it's legible. It told us what happened. This person, I said it.
She's on one.
No, she's hurt, man. This person is hurt. This person needs guidance. This person just got cheated on. It seems.
How much of this do you think is going to make it into the podcast?
I hope all of it. This is very important stuff.
I would wager zero.
No, this needs to go on. I will protest if this person does not make it into the podcast because this is a really important segment. This whole entire thing has been floating around the internet and we are a modern day show that needs to be accountable.
I play poker, man.
Yeah, but this isn't a poker show. It's a show that involves poker and other things, life things. You always like to talk about, the cryotherapy, meditation, sauna, whatever. And now I bring you real life problems.
No, those are real life problems. Okay. Those are real life solvable problems. I can get you yoked.
How much kombucha have you drank?
Zero.
I had this whole bottle though.
Good for you. Good for you, man. I hope your stomach feels better.
It does feel a lot better, actually. All right. Well, I hope you all enjoyed our new setup, the new vlogcast, all these gifts. If you want to send us gifts, be in contact with Matt Berkey's Twitter account. Be in contact with my Twitter account. I'll give you an address. I'll give you a Patreon link. Whatever it is you want. And I will give you my Venmo.